There's really nobody like me. It's amazing. But critique is different. I think we also are not good at taking critique. You critique somebody, oh, a thankful hater. Oh, you
enemy
see,
of progress.
Enemy of progress. Guy, it's a critique. Sometimes you're gonna have to take it on the chin. So that we can't be doing things. We can't let made in Ghana be inferior product.
Charlie, what happened? This is M.anifest. And you're tuned to the journey with Nayoka. You need this, you want this, you need to stay tuned to this. Peace, 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 peace.
Sabaning room massase, Ubu Mummy Amedase, we in Sawa Mukase, Tabuasi, Mamisha.
Hello and welcome to The Journey Ghana. My name is Nayoka Oware. I hope you're ready for this because it is going to be good. So stay tuned.
I've been up from early, traveling on my journey, wading through the water, it's sort of been looking back.
Hello, M.anifest.
Hello.
Welcome to The Journey.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining me today.
Thank you for having me today.
You're welcome. How's your journey?
How's my journey?
Beautiful hotel, yes.
Beautiful hotel. Dusty, rough roads.
I know. I realized that I was making my way here.
It's the story of Ghana. Ghana is one big unfinished project.
You know what? Someone said that to me the other day. We're forever a developing country. When will we ever be an established country?
But it's part of the charm. This wonderful hotel and then the roads to it. Just, you know, it's more of a pleasant surprise when you get here.
Very well, very well. To me, you know, you're the contemporary version of King Ayisoba. Obviously, you're I think you are.
Interesting.
To be completely honest, the themes you rap about and your style as well. Where do you derive from? What part of Ghana are you from?
Well, I'm from Sirgwe in the Volta region. That's my father's side. My mother's side is Asante Mampong from the Asante region.
Nice. Have you ever lived there?
So I'm mixed. No, I haven't, but I've been to, especially the Volta region, on numerous occasions for funerals and things of the sort. You know, funerals are quite the social magnet for us here in Ghana.
I realize. Yeah. There's a saying that Ghanaians like, well, not death as such, but something along those lines.
You have to say goodbye well. I wish it wasn't that expensive to say goodbye in Ghana, but it is quite expensive, you know. It is expensive, but it brings people together.
Very true. Now let's talk about you.
Okay.
When did your music career begin?
Well, the seeds were planted too early for me
I
to
like
remember
that.
Yeah. And it always began, my journey began with the gift of writing. I think I started writing early. I can't remember what age, before I was 10.
What did you start writing, like poetry?
It's a good question. What? Any and everything that I wanted to. I didn't have a format. I would write random things, and I think my grandfather came from the US and brought one of those old Apple Macintosh, the very the ones with the floppy disk, the old, super old.
This was like years.
Yeah, and so that also gave me a new reason to want to write, because I wanted to get on the computer and type. And then in my teenage years, I developed a little bit of courage, not too much, just a little bit, to be able to turn that into rap. So, and I developed a bit of courage to then write my own raps, and then to actually join a rap group when I was 14. But the name of the rap group was Rebel Camp. And so after that, I entered another world where I was exploring myself as a person and not really taking music that, always took music seriously, but as something that was going to become a big part of my life, not necessarily, but I spent a lot more time delving deeper. And then by 2005, I had that fork in the road, come to Jesus moment with music, and I chose.
Wow, what a story. You migrated to Minneapolis.
Yes.
Some years back, and you graduated with a BA in economics.
Mm-hmm.
Why didn't you pursue that? Why did you decide to take this career path and choose music, really? Or did music choose you?
Well, there are selfish reasons behind my choice. I think I'd rather be extraordinary at something that I'm gifted and supposed to do than be average or good in something else that, you know, wasn't meant for me.
That's not selfish.
No, it's a selfish choice because at the same time, people have had to bear with me, you know, in terms of, it's a very unorthodox path, and it has its peaks and valleys. And
even for a Ghanaian?
And not just the Ghanaian, for everybody. Being a creative or an artist is a very unorthodox choice, and the people around you might not understand. Time spent, time not being able to be spent, relationships might suffer. Why didn't I get that nice job on Wall Street?
Or that 9-to-5, yeah.
You understand? Yeah, but I did have a job for a while, and so I was both doing music full-time and a job.
What were you doing?
I was working with a nonprofit as a development analyst.
M.anifest, was the transition from being a rap artist in America to now a renowned African artist quite difficult for you?
The transition is still going on. Yeah.
Is that so?
Yeah, I don't think it's a transition that happens in a short while. Was it difficult? It is difficult, but it's a very enjoyable difficult. If you want to flourish, you're either a sink or swim. You make a choice. Unless, of course, maybe you have a great big inheritance and the music is just, you know, something
you do on the side,
you know, just to, you know, pleasure yourself every now and then. I know that sounds a bit weird, but
but
yeah, but otherwise you have to resolve.
I can tell you like a challenge.
Yeah, you must like a challenge. Yeah, no risk, no reward in that regard.
You refer to yourself as being unapologetically African. Mm-hmm. Can you elaborate?
Well, it wasn't always so. I think that, once again, the seeds were sown very young. There's a picture of me, I'll send it to you, when I was 4 or 5 years old. With my mother, and we're in Pittsburgh visiting my grandparents. And I'm dressed how I dress these days. So I guess it's been, some parts of it has been always there. I don't have English names, for instance. I just have, you know, all Ghanaian names.
What is your name?
Kwame Amitipichi Kata. Those little things existed. It's better. Another one. the average original is better than a good copy, right? Now, me trying to copy or trying to, which I did, you know, like, nutty by nature, but it's a dash effect.
I used to do that.
No, but it's amazing. It's a process that you go through. But you realize then that you're supposed to evolve out of that to come more back to yourself.
And some people don't.
Some people don't. And also I had the great privilege of having been removed from my country. Self-imposed exile. And what that does for you is you either crumble and assimilate or you stand firm in who you are. And I guess that is...
You released your first solo album in 2009 to raise awareness. 2007?
Yeah. 2009 was the second one.
Okay, and it was to raise awareness about the funds for a non-profit organization called Young Entrepreneurs Africa.
Yeah.
Tell me more about the organization.
Well, a friend of mine, Lindy, had this idea about the fact that we always have our hands out for handouts. Mm. Instead of building the tools and entrepreneurship and stuff. People forget that people like Dangote and stuff made money from Gary and cement and, you know. So instead of opting for always begging, we could give people the tools to think, not to think of how am I going to do great so that I can beg for money and they'll give it to me because I have this, but how are we going to be able to create, entrepreneur? But I'm actually also co-founder of a thing called Giant Steps, which is for entrepreneurs and artists, and she and I are working to try and bring it to Ghana together. Yeah. So.
You've won a number of awards, Best Rapper of the Year, Songwriter of the Year in the US. Now, when you were sitting down writing your songs, did you ever think to yourself, yes, this song is definitely going to win me an award?
No. The day I start thinking of awards, the day I need to quit.
Because yeah. You don't do it for awards.
No, you cannot do it for that. I should actually reach a point where I offend people so much they should be terrified to nominate me for an award. They should be either, they should be terrified to nominate me, or maybe they should be driven to, because they will be terrified at people's response if they don't nominate me. You know? I don't say I don't appreciate them, but honestly, it's not my... In Chi, we say, and you're my dad, Jane. It's not a thing that I wake up and think of.
Okay, it's all about the fans. Let's talk about Damon Albarn from the Gorillaz.
Mm-hmm.
How important was that interaction for you?
I think it opened some great... That interaction opened some great doors. And it taught me also sort of the possibilities of in terms of collaborations and... And all that stuff.
Goodness,
it was, yeah. I mean, and like touring with him and Flea and Tony Allen was just amazing, because first of all, it's amazing playing the music and doing something new and refreshing and interesting. Second of all, it's just like it's a whole different level of how things are organized. And it was amazing in that regard. Met a lot of great musicians working with Damon. That's how I actually also met Erykah Badu and worked with her. You know.
How did you feel when you first heard that you would be collaborating with Erykah?
I tried to keep it cool. I tried to pretend I was cool.
Yeah,
you know, you have to. I was trying to say, oh, me too, I'm cool. But I know it was exciting because I listened to her a lot when I was younger.
How old are you?
I'm 31. I'm pretty old these days.
No, that's still quite young.
Yeah.
What was she like as a person?
She was great. I think she is as we see her to be. She's very charming and enchanting and.
Yeah.
Okay.
When you get on stage and you hear like the fans screaming your name and chanting and rapping along,
I pass out. I'm kidding. No, I'm joking.
Like, do you feel elated, or are you like, this is just my job? I'm really here to entertain my fans.
It's in a strange way. It's neither. It's closer to elated, but elated is not the word. Elated is what I think happens when I was younger, and it would be like everyone say, yeah, that was speech and prize giving day, and you get a prize and you're just happy because your parents are there and they're happy for you. But I think this is more of a feeling of fulfillment and purpose at the same time. This is what I'm supposed to be doing, and it's actually working. People are here, they're excited to see me, and now here's to delivering and doing something awesome.
You sometimes just let them sing and just stand there and watch them?
Yeah, especially I do quite a bit of acapellas now, you know, because I think it's, well, ultimately, when you're lyrical, it's a part people want to sometimes enjoy by itself.
Definitely.
They want to be able to just hear that and be able to echo it out and hear themselves and everybody else and feel part of something special. Mm-hmm. So I'm always part of it. It's almost like I'm standing outside of myself and I'm being part of that experience sometimes. And it's dope. It's dope to have that. I want to create more of that.
How does life's daily frustrations affect your new work?
Now here, you don't need just one plan. You need plan A, B, C, D, E. You need contingency plans. For contingency plans, lights might go off, you know.
Yes.
Somebody will not show up. Ghana, they will be on GMT, Ghana Man time. I mean, you need to have ways to be efficient in an inefficient place. And so that part can just be slow. You know, Ghana, you ask somebody, say, Charlie, how be things? They'll be like, normal. I want normal. It's not for me. I'm not built that way.
M.anifest, how do you avoid being jaded?
The vortex, being caught in the vortex. How do I avoid being jaded? I learned to remember the simple things in life, you know.
Which are?
You know, love, spending time on and with people that you care about, not on people that frustrate you, annoy you. Ghana is lovely. You can take a trip to Adan, outside of Accra. You can go to Akosombo. You can go to different places and you'll be refreshed. I've been to Adan how many times this year? Only once. which is
like
a pity.
To go there.
Yeah, you should enjoy it, you know.
I love it.
Live the life, jet skis, speed boats.
Ooh, well, I can't swim.
I can't swim either, but I love
so
water.
It's safe.
Yeah, you're fine. What's the worst that could happen?
I could fall out.
Prince Charming will come. Then you see who loves you.
I hope somebody would love
you. Yeah, enough to, yeah.
To come after
yeah.
me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's evident that American artists have a great influence on, you know, African
mm-hmm.
artists
mm-hmm. Definitely.
As well. Do you think that African artists could ever have that kind of influence over them?
Yes, and if the time is, any time is this time, where they are experiencing a very manufactured creative world, whether it's American Idol, everything is just manufactured so much that people can't wait to find inspiration elsewhere. So this is our time to channel that into our creative work in intentional ways or in ways that is mind-blowing, so that instead of us always talking about, yo, we're trying to go to the Grammys, we're trying to whatever, they should be like, yo, we need to go to Ghana and see what is really good. Even similar to what happened with Azonto in Ghana. Because it broke the rules, it did something. You're not supposed to dance that way, but you are, you know?
I do.
That's what I'm saying, exactly. So, but then what does that do? When we are comfortable being ourselves and doing, and breaking the mold and expressing ourselves, people, it will come to, that attention will come to us and people would be want to be inspired. You know, even our cousins and Nigerians often...
Cousins.
Yeah, they were our first cousins. That's why we have such a sibling rivalry. We, you know, managed to take Azonto further than Ghanaians could or know how to be, you know, and...
Why is that?
We need to strive for excellence more. I always like to say, and I'll keep saying it to, I hope everybody hears it, what we lack in finances, we have to make up in creativity. We all know we have other problems. That goes to show that we think things that are African are inferior. Me, I am a product of Ghana and America. That gives me a certain understanding of certain things. So why can't I use that properly, instead of trying to be like, okay, so now, yeah, now I'm saying it's unnecessary because we see ourselves as inferior. We don't fancy ourselves enough. We need to fancy ourselves a bit more.
Well, so. I've been told innumerable times mm-hmm. that our minds are being conditioned. Do you ever think that will change?
Yeah. If I didn't, I would really have quit and worked on Wall Street or something a long time ago because it would be an exercise in futility. No, but I think we can... little we can change how we think about ourselves. We can just start by the fact that we fancy ourselves. We should start from that.
How?
Bit of self-esteem. What do you do to, this is the question.
What do you fancy yourself?
Well, we better the things we do, and that's the, if you were to see this and you were like, oh, this is dope, who made it or where did you get it, whatever, made in Ghana by my tailor, this is a people, sometimes that's those are the small things. So that we can't be doing things, we can't let made in Ghana be inferior product.
They're going to have to start with their minds, their mentality.
Yeah, so the people who create are a big part of that. People who create usually have been fortunate enough to have had disturbed lives so that we've been disturbed, and so our conditioning sometimes has been thrown off, so we're not on that because, you know, we're on something else. So as a creative, then how do you, instead of being frustrated and being like, artists here sometimes will be, but Ghanaians don't like good music. Sorry, my guy, but if they're not hearing it, you know, and hearing that it's maybe at least even a tenth of as much as they're hearing all the rubbish, then, you know, and it will take time. It might not be your first album. It takes time. That's the thing. Do we have that patience? There's nobody who's done anything super innovative that had it easy from whatever.
Mm.
It's always resistance. It's not always the easy thing, but the reward is always greater. It's always, always greater.
Yes. Tell me about one of the challenges you faced trying to break into the music industry. I'm sure you faced like dozens.
Unfortunately, pettiness amongst artists who should be natural allies sometimes, you know, because everybody has this entitlement thing. I think we also are not good at taking critique. You critique somebody, oh, a thankful hater. Oh, you
enemy
see,
of progress.
Enemy of progress. Guy, it's a critique. Sometimes you're going to have to take it on the chin and keep it moving. You know, the people who love you sometimes will probably give you the best critique. People see the glamour and they see the excitement that comes with what I do or what people like me do, and they think it's easy to be with a person like me. But then when you're on the other side of the fence, when you are a partner to a set person like me, you have the challenges of having to share me with the world. The journey has been good relationship-wise, and the failures are all part of it, you know what I mean? Yeah, I was jaded for a little while, but I was little.
Okay now?
Yeah, I'm good.
So what's next for you?
Next is taking things to the next level. Now that I've put my foot in the ground on the continent, I think doing things infrastructure-wise, definitely doing more touring. I think it's excellent to be able to take what we do from here and take it everywhere and then come back home and to a hero's welcome and crowd surf. I'm definitely interested in doing things that will help not just myself but others. I think at some point I'm going to own a performance space. We don't have many of them here. Another things that I can't say because, you know, people try and water down my idea and do it and spoil it.
No, we'll discuss it later.
Yeah.
M.anifest, I want to thank you so much.
I want to thank you too.
Journey. And I have a gift for you.
Wow, amazing.
Journey and your fans so much.
Amazing. Thank you.
Wow. We seem as though we should give back to you.
A gift?
This is my treasure chest.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
This is mine?
That is yours.
Wow.
I hope you like it. I didn't know what to get you. Your style is so, you know, unique, so distinctive. So I just thought one word on a t-shirt.
One word on a t-shirt.
Yes.
The packaging was quite, you know, it was quite well done. It built the anticipation. It felt like drum roll.
I feel as though it describes you well.
Okay. Describes me well. Whoa! Thank you so much. Nice. I'm going to wear this. This is going to be Instagrammed. That's why I need to call myself.
Illest.
The illest man.
The illest man. I like that. That should be your new title. So thank you once again.
Thank you very much too. This works. It's amazing. If I do a song called this, you'll be responsible for it.
Yes.
Yeah, you'll be responsible for all the braggadocio that will come with this. Thank you very much.
Nowadays, every brugger got my own agenda. Every George of the jungle wants to be Simba. I simper. See them smile like they mean well, but me well. I want proof like M.D. 12. Look, I need-